We are discussing chapter number 11, which is thermal properties of matter. Thermal properties of matter. Or you might have noticed or felt in sunny afternoon that it's quite hotter as compared to a windy night. Why? This is because of the difference in temperatures. The temperature is high in the afternoons if you compare it with the night. So information about the thermal properties of matter, we are going to see about that. What is the heat? What is the heat transferred? How temperature comes into play? So we can just say that temperature is more if heat is more, or we can say temperature is less when heat is less. Temperature is more when we are in hot sunny day, and temperature is less for the ice cold water. Temperature is what? Temperature is defined as the degree. Please understand, it is the measure of the degree of hotness or coldness of a body. So it is not defined as hotness or coldness, but measure of degree of hotness and coldness of a body. So a cup of hot soup or a scoop of ice cream, if you take an example, so the measure of degree of hotness of this hot soup is higher than the measure of degree of hotness of the ice cream, and you can take vice versa also. So heat is an energy. It's a form of energy which is transferred between two systems. A system and all other things are the surroundings. And why the heat is transferred or the energy is transferred? Because there is a temperature difference. If say 30 degree is one item or say system, and 70 degree is the surrounding. So the energy will, or the heat will try to go from 70 to 30 to make it 50, and this will also become 50. So it's a kind of becoming or coming to the same level or equilibrium. For example, if you ask for a coffee and you suddenly get a call and you started talking, after a while, after say 5 or 10 minutes of a call, this coffee is going to, means it was hot when it was served, but after 10 minutes it will be a cold coffee. Okay, why? Because the heat is being dissipated or transferred, or you can say energy is being transferred to the surroundings. This is what is happening here. After some time, we'll see this hot cup will become cold. So the SI unit of heat is joule, and we have some commonly used unit which are calorie and kilocalorie. So what is the relationship between joule and calorie? 1 calorie is 4.18 joule, and 1 kilocalorie is 1000 calories. The SI unit of temperature is Kelvin. You know, you will be amazed to know that it is not degree centigrade, because we are used to know about the degree centigrade, talk about the degree centigrade, but the SI unit is Kelvin. But they are commonly used units which are Fahrenheit and Celsius. So degree Fahrenheit, degree centigrade, and there is all sorts of conversion which are going on in between. How to measure the temperature? How we are going to measure the temperature? See, temperature is measured with the help of a device which is known as thermometer. When you are ill, then the doctor will put, if you are a kid, then he will or she will put a thermometer in your armpit. If you are, you say you are an adult, then it will be put in your mouth below your tongue. Why? Because these are the temperature area. If you are suffering from a fever, it can be diagnosed. It can be then treated. So temperature is measured with the help of thermometer. Mercury and alcohol, they are commonly used liquids in the liquids in glass thermometers. So this is a mercury in thermometer. This thermometer has some initial marking, some final marking, and then there is a blue line here. This is nothing but mercury which has risen to this point. This is showing the temperature. So in order to construct a thermometer, we need two fixed points as a reference point. So these fixed points are known as freezing point, ice point, and boiling point, steam point. So the water freezes and boils at these two temperatures under standard pressure. The ice and steam point in Fahrenheit are 32 degree Fahrenheit and 212 degree Fahrenheit. So it has 180. See, the difference between these two are 180. If you subtract them, it will be 180. So there are difference of, or you can say 180 equal intervals between two reference points. And on Celsius scale, you start with 0 and you end up with 100. So 0 is for ice and 100 is for steam. So these are the two points, ice point and steam point. So it has 100 equal intervals between two reference points. If you want to see it graphically or show it graphically, this is the temperature in Celsius from 0 to 100. And same case, at 0 degrees centigrade, you have 32 Kelvin. At 100 degrees centigrade, you have 212. See, this is 212 Kelvin. This is how the conversion goes, or this is how the relation between these two goes. So there is an equation also that this TF, temperature in Fahrenheit, if you subtract with 32 divided by 180, it will give you temperature in Celsius, which is divided by 100. So this is TC is nothing but the Fahrenheit temperature. TC is the Celsius temperature. Ideal gas equation and absolute temperature. A thermometer that uses any gas gives the same reading. Any gas will give any reading, or so you can say same reading, regardless of which gas is used. Please understand, any gas can be used because all gases have same expansion at low temperature. And the gases' behavior are described by the quantity of the gas, the pressure, the volume, the temperature, PVT you can say. So this temperature is nothing but the this centigrade temperature plus 273.15. Gases which have low density, they obey two laws, Boyle's law and Charles' law. Now, Boyle's law says that at constant temperature, pressure and volume remains constant. Whereas, the Charles' law says that at constant pressure, volume divided by temperature remains constant, same. So, if you combine these two, you just saw, this PV will be equal to RT. R is the universal gas constant, and the value of R is this much, 8.31 joule per mole per Kelvin. So PV is equal to R2 is the ideal gas equation, which is applicable for low temperature, only at low temperature. Please understand, only at low temperature. For any quantity of dilute gas, you can use PV equal to mu RT. Here mu is the number of moles of the sample of the gas. At constant volume, the gas thermometer temperature varies with respect to the pressure. So temperature now changes linearly with increase in pressure. What I say, what I want to intend is the increase in temperature will give this increase in the pressure. So temperature increase, if temperature is increased, the pressure is increased. Absolute zero. This is defined as the minimum absolute temperature of an ideal gas. Please understand, absolute temperature is the minimum absolute temperature of an ideal gas. So if we plot pressure versus temperature, that is P versus T, we get a straight line. From pressure and temperature, we get a straight line. But if we extend this backwards to the x-axis, here is a point. So the minimum temperature is found to be what? Here, 273.15 experimentally, and this is known as absolute zero, but it is on the left-hand side, that is the negative x-axis. So the relation between the temperature in Kelvin and Celsius is given by, this temperature is given by the TC plus 273.15. The triple point of neon and carbon dioxide. See, the triple point is a point where solid, liquid, gas, three states exist together. So the triple point of neon and carbon dioxide are this and this. Express these temperature on the Celsius and Fahrenheit scale. So we know the relationship between the Fahrenheit and Celsius. TF is equal to 9 by 5 TC plus 32. For neon, the this Kelvin is this much. So you can easily find out what will be in degree centigrade. You just have to subtract it from 273.15 Kelvin, and this gives you minus 248.58. Now this expression we are going to use to convert the temperature in centigrade into the Fahrenheit. So this is in Fahrenheit. Similarly, we will do with this 216.55. What we will do? We will take this value, subtract it from 273.15 in order to get it in centigrade. Then we will use again this equation in order to find out the value in Fahrenheit. So this is the final value. Two absolute scales A and B have triple points of water defined to be this and this. What is the relationship between TA and TB? So again, the triple point is the point where solid, liquid, gas, they exist together. So triple point of water on absolute scale T1, A, T1 will be 200, say A is a variable. Triple point of water on absolute scale B, T2 is 350 B. So triple point of water on Kelvin scale TK will be 273.515, this we know. So the temperature 273.15 K on Kelvin scale is what? It is equal to 200 A on absolute scale A. So you said T1 will be equal to TK. So you say 200 A equal to 273.15. So you get A equal to 273.15 by 200. Now the temperature at 273.15 K on Kelvin scale is equivalent to 350, this one, this 350 B on absolute scale. So again we equate T2 with TK. That this means 350 B will be equal to 273.15. So you get B, that is this, the 273.15 by 350. So TA is the triple point of water of scale and TB is the triple point of water on scale B. So these two has to be together. You can say this into TA will be equal to this into TA will be equal to this into TB into TA. So we equate them, so TA will be equal to 200 by 350 TB, which is equivalent to 4 by 7. So there is a comparison between Kelvin, Celsius and Fahrenheit temperature scale. See, this is the absolute zero. This is zero of, you can say, degree centigrade. This is Fahrenheit. If you see, at 0 degree centigrade, it is 32 Fahrenheit or it is 273.15. With these are the ice points, and this is how we use the conversion between these three. At 100 degree it is at Fahrenheit 212, whereas the steam point is 373.15. Thermal expansion, you might have seen how things expand when the temperature increases. So thermal expansion is the phenomena of increasing the dimensions of body. It can be lengthwise, area wise, volume wise expansion when the temperature is increased. So there are certain examples of thermal expansion. The water is cold at the top of a lake because it expands and becomes less dense. So when this water freezes, it will insulate the water below, you know, from outside. This means the cold air is like it makes a blanket here. This is a blanket. So this is because of which the fish, the flora and fauna below this icing can survive here. Even though the top layer of water is frozen, in this we can see the plant and animal life is not getting affected. When we open this tap, say it's cold, freezing outside your house, so what you do, you just suddenly switch it back or switch it to the hot water. But as soon as the hot water will come, there are walls, etc., they will expand, and this water, the speed of the water or the velocity with which the water is coming out will decrease, and sometimes it will stop also. Why? Because the hot water heats the metal valve inside the tap, which expands to block off any more flow of water. This is just because of the expansion of the materials because of the temperature. So why thermal expansion? What is the reason? See, when any object is heated, the particle will start moving in random motion, and so average distance between the molecule will increase, and as a result the object appears to be expanded when heated like this. So we can see here that the atoms here are tightly packed in this scenario. But when we apply heat, they will start moving in the random direction. And the molecules are tightly packed here, but heated, they will just run random apart. So when an object is cooled, it contracts also, which is referred to as negative thermal expansion or contraction. There are types of thermal expansion: linear expansion, that is the expansion in the length, the area expansion in the area, and volume expansion, the expansion in the volume. Area expansion. This area can be defined as, or you can say area expansion can be defined as the expansion in the area because of the temperature, say delta T. So in case of this area expansion, there is increase in both the length and it can be increased in breadth also. So if we say that the area, this, just assume it to be a cube, the area was A, it changed to A plus delta A. So mathematically we can write delta A by A as A, or you can say alpha, this coefficient of alpha L you can write. So there are different books having different symbols. So here we just choose AA delta T. This AA is A sub A is the coefficient of area expansion. So this coefficient of area expansion is what? This is the degree of area expansion divided by the change in temperature. See, this is the degree of area expansion. You take delta T down below. So this will be delta A by A, which is the area expansion. Delta T is the temperature. So this one degree, coefficient of area expansion, is simply the degree of area expansion divided by the change in temperature. So what this means is that there is an increase in area of an object. If you increase the temperature or decrease the temperature, it will be somewhat less. And we denote it by this symbol, but various books, various theories take other symbol also, but the meaning or the definition remains the same. So this is the characteristics of these substances, and it varies along with the temperature. Volume expansion. So this can be defined as the expansion in the volume. Now volume is length, breadth and height. So the volume increases with temperature. This means the length, breadth and height also increases with the temperature of our substance. So we can see here that the volume is actually increasing. So if you say V is the initial volume, delta V is the addition of this. So V plus delta V is the increase in length, width and height. So the expansion of, you can say in volume, due to increase in temperature, mathematically we can write that this AV, this is the coefficient of volume, which is degree of volume expansion delta V by V by this delta T divided by temperature. So AV is like delta V by V by delta T. It is denoted by AV, and characteristics of a substance, it varies with temperature, as you see here. If you plot a graph between this AV and temperature, then you see a very interesting thing happening here when we talk about volume. Initially, this AV is changing a lot. If temperature is increasing, this AV is linear, is varying linear here with temperature. But as you go ahead, it will vary not linearly but non-linearly. But as you go at higher temperature, it becomes constant. So this is the coefficient of volume expansion of copper as a function of temperature. So as you see, first the copper goes linear, or you can say the coefficient of linear volume expansion goes linear, then it takes a non-linear path, and then it becomes constant. Thermal expansion of solids and liquids are quite small. There is an anomaly, you can say, in the behavior of water. What is this anomalous behavior of water as compared to other scenarios? Say water shows some exceptional behavior, because when it is heated at 0 degree centigrade, it contracts, or it instead of expanding, it contracts. And this happens at till 4 degree centigrade. So you see here, at 0 degree, till 4 degree, it is going to contract. So the volume of the given amount of water is minimum at 4 degree centigrade. This is the volume of water. This is the temperature. So volume is minimum here, that is density is the highest, density is maximum. After 4 degree it will start expanding, see it is start expanding, and below 4 the volume increases and therefore the density decreases. So this means the water has maximum density at 4 degree centigrade. 4 degree centigrade water has maximum density and minimum volume. This is the anomaly of water, and this is the property by which the water in lakes and ponds freeze only at the top layer and bottom it does not. But if the water freezes at the bottom also, then what will happen to the flora and fauna, animal and plants? This is the anomalous behavior, anomaly in water behavior given by our Almighty, so that every, you know, aquatic animals should also live. If we plot temperature on x-axis and density on y-axis, we obtain this kind of graph. So what do we get here? We get an information that the density will increase till 4 degree and it decreases now after 4 degree. Same as the previous graph, it was showing the volume, and here it is showing the density. So it was decreasing till 5, here the density is increasing till 4. It is density is increasing till 4, and after that density is decreasing here. Previously the volume increased after 4 degree. So what is the relationship between AV and AL? The relation is simply AV is equal to 3AL. This you have to just remember, 3AL. So there is a relationship between the coefficient of linear expansion, which is this one, and coefficient of volume expansion, which is this one. So AV equal to 3AL. And in order to derive this relation, we can consider a block of cube, which is initially say of length L. And suppose we increase the temperature from T to delta T, because of this result, the length also increased to L plus delta L, and AL is, we know all these formulas, so AL is delta L by L by delta T. So AL, just take delta L here and take everything or push everything on the left hand side. So delta L will be this one. Now the temperature increases to delta T, the volume will increase to V plus delta V. So delta V is the change in volume. So we can write delta V as L plus delta L whole cube minus L cube. This is the change. This was the volume was here L cube, and then initially the delta L increased, so L plus delta L is the final length, so this cube is the volume. So we take the subtraction of these two so that we can find out the change in the volume delta V. By solving we get delta V equal to 3 L square delta L. We just have to ignore this delta L square delta L cube, because this will be very very less number as compared to L. So finally we get delta V equal to 3 V delta L by L, which is eventually 3 V. This is nothing but delta L by this delta L by L by delta T is nothing but, we can just divide it, delta T multiplied by delta T. This scenario becomes AL, and this whole becomes AV. Delta V by V, take V on this side, delta T on the down below, and you get AV equal to 3AL. This is the relationship between coefficient of volume expansion and coefficient of linear expansion. Thermal stress. Mechanical stress, whenever there is an increase or in temperature or decrease in temperature, there is expansion and contraction in the body. When an object is heated or cooled, it will either expand or contract. That is why there is a mechanical stress. There is a continuous stress in the body. This is called the thermal stress, and this thermal stress is because of the temperature increase or decrease. So whenever we design structures in say in railway track or highway or on bridge, some roads are being made in our roof, so the concrete will expand, it will expand or contract. So we leave spaces between them because of the mechanical stress being produced, which rises to thermal stress. Heat capacity in temperature, or the change in temperature of a substance, that is change in temperature of the substance when a given quantity of heat is absorbed or rejected by a substance, is characterized by or is being shown by a quantity called the heat capacity of that substance. So represent it by S. So S is, again let us see that when a given quantity of heat is absorbed, delta Q, or rejected by a substance which is characterized by quantity called the heat capacity. So this is T. So this delta Q is the amount of heat being supplied to the substance. This T, or you can say delta T, T plus delta T is the change in temperature. So when we come to specific heat capacity, every substance has unique value of amount being absorbed or rejected to change the temperature by a unit amount, or you can say unit mass by one unit. This quantity, say unit mass and unit by one unit, this quantity is referred to as the specific heat capacity of that substance. So mathematically we can write S is nothing but delta Q by delta T. This delta Q is the amount of heat being absorbed or rejected by a substance, and delta T is temperature change. So heat capacity and specific heat capacity only differs when we talk about the temperature is unit mass of unit mass by one unit. So this specific heat, as we just saw, is defined as the amount of heat per unit mass absorbed or rejected by a substance to change its temperature by one. We just saw that. So it is this scenario. This delta Q here is the amount of heat absorbed or rejected by the substance. M is the mass here, and delta is the change in temperature. And the SI unit of specific heat capacity is joule per kg per Kelvin. Molar specific heat capacity. So heat capacity per mole, see, this is per mole, that is why we have molar specific heat capacity. Heat capacity per mole of a substance, how it is defined? It is defined as the amount of heat, delta Q in moles, absorbed or rejected. We don't take mass M here, we take moles, amount of heat absorbed or rejected in per mole, heat capacity per mole, by a substance to change the temperature by one unit. So this C is given by S by mu, which is equal to delta Q by mu delta T. And what all values are here, mu is the number of moles, C is the molar specific heat capacity of the substance. This delta Q is the amount of heat absorbed or rejected by the substance, and delta T is of course the temperature change. So this also depends on the nature of substance and the temperature. The SI unit of molar heat capacity or molar specific heat capacity is joule per mole per Kelvin. Molar specific heat capacity and molar specific heat capacity for constant pressure and constant temperature. So Cp, C sub P and C sub V. So if the gas is held under constant pressure during the heat transfer, then the corresponding molar specific heat capacity is called the molar specific heat capacity at constant pressure. While in this case, if the volume of the gas is maintained during the heat transfer, then the corresponding molar specific heat capacity will be known as molar specific heat capacity at constant volume. Here it was constant pressure, here is constant volume. So water has specific heat capacity, highest specific heat capacity, that therefore we use it as a coolant in automobile radiators and in hot water bags, as you see here. In an experiment on the specific heat of a metal, this kg block of metal at 150 degree centigrade is dropped in a copper calorimeter. The water equivalent is this much, containing 150 centimeter cube of water at 27 degree centigrade. The final temperature is 40 degree centigrade. We have to compute the specific heat of the material. If heat losses to the surroundings are not negligible, is your solution greater or smaller than the actual value of the specific heat of the metal? So mass of the metal is given, change it into gram. Initial temperature of metal is given, 150 degree centigrade. Final temperature of the metal is also given. The calorimeter has some water equivalent. So that's it, that is equal to this. The water equivalent is this much. So that we can convert it into gram. The volume of the water is also given, 150 centimeter cube. The mass of water can easily be found out at temperature 27 degree. What will be the mass? Mass will be volume into density. So we have the volume. The density of water at this temperature is 1, and essentially it is 1 only. So 150 gram is the mass. So what is the fall in the temperature? See, it was 150 degree initially, it came down to 40. So what is the temperature difference? It is 150 minus 40, that is 110 degree centigrade. And what is the specific heat of the water? This is 4.118, this is a fixed value. So specific heat of the metal, let us assume it to be C. So heat lost by the metal will be what gained by the calorimetry instrument substance. So this theta we can say MC delta T. So the rise in the temperature of water and calorimeter system will be what? See, it was 40 and then 27 degree we found out. I want to share one thing. This is 40 degree, okay. This is 40 degree and then we have the water at 27. So 27 and 40 degree, the final temperature is this. So there is a difference of how much? 13 degree. And the heat gained by water and calorimetry system, if you take the same formula, delta theta dash will be M1, that is the whole system, 150 plus 25 plus Cw, that is the water specific heat we are going to take, and delta T. So these two are equal, this one and the previous, this one and two are equal because the heat gain is heat accepted. So Mc delta T will be equal to M plus M dash Cw delta T. So here we see we have to find out the specific heat. This already we know, M also we know. 110 is the temperature we found out. This is the whole mass of the system, 150 plus 25. This is 4.186. We know that delta T is 13 degree here. So just equate it, you can get the C here, which is 0.43. So if some heat is lost to the surrounding, then the value of C will be smaller than the actual value. Calorimetry. Now calorimetry is made up of two words. Calorie means heat and metry means the measurement. So the calorimetry means measurement of what? Heat. So calorimetry is defined as the heat transfer from body at higher temperature, that is the higher temperature, to a lower temperature. But there should be no loss of heat to the atmosphere. So what is the principle of calorimetry? This is heat loss by one body is equal to the heat gained by another body. So the device which measures calorimetry is known as the calorimeter. This is the calorimeter. This consists of a metallic vessel and a stirrer. Both are made of same material, which is copper and aluminium. And the vessel is kept in wooden jacket. If you see, this is a wooden jacket. So there is no lead heat loss. A mercury thermometer can be inserted here through a very small opening in the outer jacket. This is how calorimeter is being made. Change in state. The transition from solid to liquid, or solid to liquid or gas, or gas to liquid or solid, these are all changing of state, right? We can see that the ice changes to water, water changes to the vapor or gas. The change from solid ice to liquid is known as melting. Change from water to solid is known as fusion. So this is how temperature and time is varying. With if you increase the temperature, there is a way in the change of state takes place. Thermal equilibrium is what? This thermal equilibrium at this state, there is no loss or gain of heat which is taking place. So the temperature at which the solid and liquid states of the system are in thermal equilibrium with each other, we call it as a melting point. So this depends on the substance and the pressure, and the melting point of a substance at certain, or you can say standard atmospheric pressure, is the normal melting point. Regulation. This is a phenomena in which the freezing point of water is lowered by the application of pressure. You have seen it, the glaciers and a girl which is skating on snow. So this is an example of regulation. Now the regulation, what is the cause of regulation? See, if we have a block of ice and this copper wire by two masses here, if you will observe, the copper wire can pass through the ice block. This is because why? Because the copper is the good conductor of heat. This one, it passes through the ice, it gets freezes, or you can say it gets refreeze, as the copper will generate heat, and this heat will pass quickly to the ice below, and this start melting because there is increase in the pressure, which lowers the temperature, as a result of which the wire will again move to the ice. So this is called the regulation. Vaporization. When liquid, here liquid changes to vapor. So the change of state from liquid to vapor is called vaporization. The temperature at which the liquid and vapor states of the systems they coexist is known as boiling point. What is the normal boiling point means? The boiling point at standard atmospheric pressure is the normal boiling point. This depends on substance and pressure and increases with increase in pressure and vice versa. If you go to higher altitude, the density of air becomes thinner. So, why? Because there is a less pressure. At high altitudes, external pressure on the water is decreased. So, you know, it will take less energy to break the water. So, if less energy is required, it means less heat is required, less temperature. So, if you see at the higher altitude, the water will boil at lower temperature. Sublimation is directly solid to vapor, the transition of solid to vapor. You have seen during the sublimation, solid changes to vapor without going into intermediary liquid state. Both the solids and vapor states of the substance where they coexist, this is known as they are coexisting at thermal equilibrium. If you see the naphthalene balls, it sublimes into gaseous state. The dry ice, that is solid carbon dioxide, sublimes to iodine. Let us summarize. Heat is a form of energy that flows between body and the surrounding medium by virtue of the difference in the temperature between two. So, the degree of hotness of the body is quantitatively, the degree of hotness or the coldness of a body is known as the temperature. So, we have thermometer, which is the temperature measuring device. This is using the measurable property called the thermometric property, that is the change in temperature. And different thermometer lead to different temperature scale. In order to construct a temperature scale, two fixed points are chosen, assign some arbitrary value of temperature. So, two number fix the origin of the scale, that is higher and lower. And then in between we have the unit size of the unit. So, this Celsius temperature Tc and the Fahrenheit can be related like this, Tf equal to 9 by 5 Tc plus 32. If you want to have a look of ideal gas equation which connects the pressure, volume and temperature, it is Pv equal to mu Rt. Mu is the number of moles, R is the universal gas constant. In the absolute temperature scale, the zero of the scale in the absolute zero of temperature minus the temperature where substance in nature has the least possible molecular activity. So, this is Tc, which is related to the T. What is this? This Tc is the Celsius scale. So, the Kelvin absolute temperature, this scale T has the same unit size as the Tc, but the origin is differing by 273.15. There are three modes of heat transfer: conduction, convection and radiation. So, in conduction, the heat is transferred between neighbors or neighboring parts of body through molecular collision without any flow of water. If you have a bar of length say L and uniform cross section A, and the ends are maintained at say Tc and Td, the rate of flow H will be given by this expression. This K is the thermal conductivity of the material of the bar. Newton's law of cooling also says that the rate of cooling of a body is proportional to the excess temperature of the body or surrounding. So, this is the K, which is the constant of proportionality. Here T2 and T1, or you can say T1 is the temperature of the surrounding medium, T2 is the temperature of the body. We have a table here showing that the amount of substance is represented by mu, temperature in Celsius Tc, Kelvin is capital T, coefficient of linear expansion alpha L, coefficient of volume expansion alpha V, the relationship between alpha V and alpha L is alpha V is equal to 3 into alpha L. The Kelvin absolute temperature is, you know, you can get Tc, that is Tc Celsius temperature, by subtracting 273.15 by capital T, which is this number. And of course, the heat supplied to the system is given by delta Q, which is energy, so it is in joules, so Q is not a state variable. Specific heat we have S, thermal conductivity we have K, which is H equal to minus Ka dT by dx. So, this is a very short description about thermal properties of matter, and we just gone through it so that we'll be able to solve the questions quickly with a bit of information here. Thank you so much and take care of yourself.